this feature, which is available under Linux or Unix, is essential to give the users the ability to access the internet and to give them some kind of restrictions.
Dr. Salah, thank you. Believe me, I am trying to set a lab with a 100 machine or less. So this talk, today's segment is very useful to many, to me as well as many other people. Let's take a break, our dear viewer, after which I will tell you all you need to know about. Welcome again, our dear viewer. Many people are talking nowadays here in Kuwait as well as internationally about e-learning. But what is this new term, m-learning? Perhaps as we can guess from this picture, it is something related to mobile learning. So let us start by posing this question. What can you learn from a cell phone? In fact, ultimately anything. Nowadays, many people are using their cell phones as in the place of their PCs or perhaps laptops, as it carries a lot of functionalities. As we spoke about earlier, there is pictures, video cameras, movies, messages, text messages, MMS, lots of services that you can benefit perhaps for your financial applications. There are 3 billion people all over the world walking with cell phones, powerful computers in their pockets. That's what we call cell phones or perhaps smartphones. Some people call them PDAs, personal digital assistants. So what is this term mobile learning? One of the most significant developments in educational technology in recent years is the mobile learning, that is m-learning, wireless education. It is applied in this domain, wireless education. Wireless and e-learning partner together in giving successful collaboration for learning using technology devices. Some universities, or what we call e-universities, offer their courses by the internet, so students all over the world can attend and take their courses. Such projects proved how important is the alliance between technologies, different infrastructures, different environments. Even the academics and the students in today's competitive global environment can benefit from such technology. It is widely used in many countries nowadays, universities, colleges, all introducing this wireless technology into the campus life. In campus, you don't need to connect your computer via wire or cable. Anywhere you go, library, in the playground, anywhere in the gym, you can sit down and your computer is connected. You can do your campus work. So the wireless connectivity is very important nowadays. It gave rise to what's so-called wireless-ready learning. So these are environments overcoming the restrictions available in now in typical or usual learning environments. What are the advantages of m-learning? Students using this technology are already accustomed to 24-by-hours access to content. So material is available for you to learn from, to access throughout the day, all the time, on campus, in the library, everywhere, even at home. You can access it very comfortably at your leisure time. It will strengthen your reach into content, perhaps in consumption of this content as well. Some people are receiving information, receiving content while walking, by the way, huh? How about the hardware? What kind of hardware I can use for m-learning? There are all kinds. Think about laptops, PDAs, tablet PCs, Bluetooth devices, digital cams, MP3 players, such as the iPod. Even the iPod, not to mention your mobile, huh? Dr. Salah, I have a question for you. Talking about tablet PC, I visited countries where they use tablet PCs in schools, perhaps for learning. But here, I didn't see in Kuwait the spread of this concept, using tablet PC in education. Why do you think the reason?
In fact, maybe the cost is one of the factors that controls this aspect, because tablet PCs are more expensive than the laptops. And also, there is another thing. Many of the internet users and students also have used to use the traditional notebook, and even some of them are also not ready to use the notebook until now. They are used to use the desktop system. So it's something should be taken consideration maybe in the near future. But in this area, I have a question to you. Have you heard about something called IVR?
IVR.
IVR, yes. It's the IVR is the interactive voice response system, which is used by mobile telecommunication vendors, and it allows you to have a kind of bidirectional interactivity, and it is being used now for mobile learning in the States and in Europe, and it allows you to have a machine that can respond to your selections of options, or maybe responds to your voice commands. You maybe you remember that I have talked in one of our previous episodes about something called Voice XML,
right?
A protocol or a technology that can be used in conjunction with the IVR systems in order to allow you to enter commands to the mobile device and to interact with that mobile device by having your voice.
Dr. Salah Kaman, you know my impression for the machines assuming the human personality. The human touch and gesture is still missing in the machine life, so you cannot put a machine to replace the human voice with the sensitive voice, the emotional voice, Dr. Salah, and the smile in the face as well. So the technology nowadays is available. Today, students are using this technology, believe it or not, in connection with the GPS devices available at their hands, perhaps in their parents' cars while driving, so they can upload and download material wherever they are wherever they are going. Multifunctionality rooms also available for students use. These rooms use mobile chairs, wireless projectors, with many interactive whiteboards to help the students perceive information. There is so-called campus social stations. These are coffee shops scattered throughout the campus that students also can connect to the internet to connect online and start using e-learning material by the network, of course, but they might require some high-speed networks. Here are some concerns for you if you are thinking about this. Cost-effective, secure networks, reliable bandwidth, as we spoke earlier. There are some gains, of course, accessibility, sophistication, compatibility, emphasis on the learning and teaching process, some saving, and standardization. All these issues, no time to speak about them, but they are carefully being considered if you are planning to implement M-learning at your organization. Here are the final conclusions. Some critics say wireless universities, such programs are dedicated primarily by financial and technological consideration. This is a controversy. Not many people agree with this. It is clear from the success stories that wireless environment have significant positive implications for teaching and learning that cannot be easily ignored. So here are alternatives to traditional environment systems, learning systems here in Kuwait. Think about it, mobile learning as opposed to wireless learning and traditional learning. Many tricks one can find in this segment and future segments. Let's take a break, our dear viewer, after which we will meet the guest for this week, Mr. Jing Chong. Welcome, our dear viewer, to the digital interview segment with you. We welcome our guest for this week, a guest from Singapore. Hello, Mr. Jing Jong.
Hello, everybody.
Nice to have you with us. Please introduce your business to the viewer and what you are doing here in Kuwait.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, it's a very interesting place. I just came here and I must say that it reminds me very much of Singapore because Singapore is raining very heavily at this point in time. And well, when I reached Kuwait, it's been raining for the last 2 days. Well, basically what I'm doing in Singapore is we run an e-learning company that supply e-learning solutions to schools, to governments, to corporates. And we supply learning management systems, content, as well as training.
Lovely. You are developing content, e-learning content to be taught in different schools. Is it restricted to Singapore only or many countries in the world?
Well, basically the content that we develop is mostly based on the Singapore school syllabus. But however, we are developing mainly in English, mathematics and science. So this content have a lot of applicability to other countries as well. And we have deployed our content to other countries as well. Yeah, such as Kuwait. We are here at the invitation of the Kuwait Smart School where we are doing an e-learning project and they are running the Singapore-style content. So we are happy to be supplying our content to Kuwait. We have also done projects in Japan, in China, in Thailand, in Brunei as well.
Question, Dr. Salah?
Yes. When we talk about content, we talk normally about different types of or different pieces of information that are scattered around across different operating systems and machines and should be put in one environment, which is the LMS or the learning management system. And this raises the issue of incompatibility. We have to talk about something related to standards like SCORM, IMS. So how can these standards help in having this kind of different type of content working in the same environment?
Well, basically the content itself, you know, the e-learning standards allow you to be able to take content that is developed and put into one portal to be moved into another portal so that it gives the users the flexibility that, for example, if they have been on this learning management system for the last 3 years, they have loaded lots of different content in it, they must be able to take that content out to another learning management system. At the same time, these days, many publishers and many content developers, they want to sell their content internationally, just like ourselves. So when we want to sell our content to be loaded into, say, the learning management systems in Kuwait Smart School, we need to make sure that it is SCORM compliant. Mm. So, well, Singapore has also been on the SCORM and the IMS standard. So we just have to package our content in the SCORM standard and we just load it up and it works perfectly well. All the tracking is being done.
Oh, very nice. Very useful, interesting subject. Mr. Yi, so you said there is e-learning is being implemented in Singapore. How, what's the percentage of the implementation and how effective it is after implementing it for so many years?
Well, basically, e-learning started in Singapore quite a number of years back. I have to draw this back to 1997 when the Ministry of Education in Singapore decided then that it wants to launch its first 5-year IT master plan. And back then, it wanted to make sure that the internet infrastructure, the computers and all that are being supplied to the schools, there are enough resources being set to the schools. And the government at first thought that they're going to have a standard solutions for every school in Singapore. But after implementing it for a while, they realized that not all schools are the same, not all teachers are the same, and not all students are the same. Different students learn at different pace. Different schools may have different types of students, or the teachers may not be so comfortable with certain type of use. So basically, now the e-learning is done in such a way that it is left to the schools to decide how best they want to deploy the e-learning. And the government in Singapore has given a lot of autonomy to the schools in Singapore. They have given the budget to the schools to plan how they want to do e-learning. Mm. So we are very fortunate that for the last 6 years that we have been in business servicing the many schools in Singapore, we have encountered schools with so many different types of learning, including mobile learning, including those who wish to use more standard content, to schools that want to do synchronous learning.
Right.
So it's a very interesting experience. And you ask about what percentage. But almost all schools in Singapore now have some form of e-learning.
All schools, 100%.
Yes, nearly all schools.
Very nice, very nice. Now, you are visiting Kuwait. You have been to Ministry of Education. You have been to private schools. You have been to public schools. The question is Kuwait ready for the e-learning project in terms of infrastructure, in terms of content, in terms of spirit to use technology inside the classroom?
Well, I must say that the infrastructure in Kuwait is very good. I use the internet. There is a wide availability of internet, and the DSL line is widely available at a very reasonable price. So I would say that the basic infrastructure is already there. I visited the school this morning. There's lots of computers. Yeah. So the main thing about e-learning, the main challenge when you want to roll e-learning, just like what Singapore did, initially you'll face certain resistance because people are not used to the ideas. Mm. People are not used to changing their ways of teaching. You need to basically want to use technology, not for the sake of technology, but it must be effective in teaching and learning. So it requires the teachers to redesign the learning and the teaching methods to involve the use of digital learning. And you also have to look at the readiness of the students. Well, but I see Kuwait students are definitely ready. There's quite a wide use of internet throughout Kuwait. So the main challenge is to get the teachers to learn how to use it very effectively.
Wait a minute, you are playing a very important note now. Teacher training, is this what you are hinting?
Oh, yes. Basically, when Singapore started the e-learning implementation in 1997, there were a lot of challenges, and we got involved in a later stage with some of the schools doing the training. And basically, you have to move them from something that they have not really been using to something that you want them to be comfortable with using and using effectively. So lots of training is required, and lots of tools are required also to make this simple. Because when we started off, we thought that perhaps the teachers could learn things like Flash, Dreamweaver, and also nice tools. These are very nice tools, but it takes a long time to learn. So in the end, what we also did was that we equipped teachers with a lot of tools that they can build interactive content very fast. Perhaps they can build a game in 1 minute, and then within a minute they can have a game that they can load up within their e-learning systems to be delivered to their students so that it can use to reinforce learning.
Learning in the 21st century, invent a minute, a game in 1 minute. Question, Dr. Salah.
I think you are talking about authoring tools in this type of question. What about authoring tools now? How can authoring tools help teachers to create contents? For example, if I'm a teacher, but I don't know how to use Flash, I don't know how to write a script in, for example, Visual Basic or something like this. So how can authoring tools help me to give the students the information they need?
I think authoring tools have come a long way from where they started off when it was two book and authorware, where it was very difficult to learn, you know, very powerful, and it's evolved. These days, even students learn Flash and all that. But I must say that even though Flash is fairly simple to use now, it is still a challenge for certain teachers to be able to learn Flash in order to build their own content. And we went through this challenge in Singapore where we had to make sure that many teachers are able to create content. So there are many types of authoring tools around, from the very sophisticated ones to those that you can just load content in a learning object format and then package it up nicely, and you can even export up with SCOM standards, IMS standards, and all that kind of things almost instantly.
Very interesting. Let's take a break, our dear viewer. We will continue this interesting interview after this fast break. Welcome again, our dear viewer. We are talking to Mr. Jing Jong. He's a visitor from Kuwait, from Singapore. He is an e-learning and IT training expert working in both fields. Mr. Jong, we are talking about services you provide, mainly three challenges: content development, LMS, and IT training. In your views, which is the most important and why?
Well, I can't really say which is more important than the other, because the reason why we are into all three was because of the unique environment that we are faced with in Singapore. We started off by providing a learning management system to schools. But however, the challenge when you provide a learning management system to school is how do you get teachers to use it when it's empty inside? Uh-huh. You may have the most powerful tools to create quizzes, to load different content up, to track users, but then there is no content inside. So faced with that challenge, we decided that we had to build content that is useful for teachers so that at least they can jump into e-learning. So basically from there, we built a lot of English, mathematics, science content. However, we faced a second challenge because content, there's so much to develop. You can never finish developing content. So we thought that we could train the teachers to build their own content. And in doing so, we also supplied this e-learning consultancy and training services in the school. We supply full-time consultants there who will also help the teachers to be able to make use of the tools more effectively. So earlier we talked about getting teachers to use content authoring tools. Yes, but there is a challenge. Teachers have a lot of good ideas, but sometimes from the idea to the development stage, they face certain technical hurdles. So we supplied the trainers to be able to help them to bridge this hurdle and even to help them build the content. So currently, that has evolved into our business in Singapore, where from the learning management system, we also build the content. Mm. And after building the content, we also supply the trainers. And so all are equally important.
I call this a cycle, the e-learning cycle. Question, Dr. Salah.
Before I ask you this question, I have to mention the role of the instructional designers in an e-learning environment. Mm. Normally, if you have an LMS system and you want the teachers to create materials, normally these teachers need to work with something called an instructional designer, who is expert in creating content for e-learning. And this leads us to talk about another question, which is the role of learning objects. Learning objects are useful and gives you the reusability feature that is fundamental for creating contents and reusing them. How can learning objects be used? And before this, can you define what is the meaning of learning objects?
Well, basically, learning object or reusable learning object is objects that are in small units, like 2 to 5 minutes of learning, that basically covers a concept, and you can actually combine these learning objects with other learning objects so that they can become a longer lessons. So we have actually developed many of this, and you can find it on our website, which we'll give you at the end of the show. In fact, that was basically how our company started developing e-learning content. We went to the schools to see what sort of content they wanted, and well, because the teachers are not always trained in instructional design, so some gave us very long content to develop. But we found some teachers with very interesting ideas that they wanted to build very interesting experimental models, short models that illustrate certain key concepts, especially concepts that students have no ability to play around with. For example, radioactivity. How can they play with an experiment to do with radioactivity? But we can build an online simulation on radioactivity, and they can go in and play with these simulations, and then the teachers can add certain worksheets and activities or certain additional instructions to go on top of it. So therefore, this is the concept of a learning object, where you have small objects and the teachers can add more things to it. And because the reusable learning objects, you can repackage it up in a different context, so it becomes very flexible.
And Dr. Mohammed, this is related to object-oriented programming. When we talk about learning objects, an object which can be used, and the object can also be a part of another larger object as a kind of building blocks.
Here we are with the viewer. We are exploring your website from Ask and Learn. Can you tell us what can we see here?
Well, basically, in our website, there are many things you can find out about the company, but there's also the demo site that you can go into, and then basically you can see some of the demo content in physics, in mathematics, and in English, and so on.
Lots of subjects here. You mentioned about something very important, Mr. Yi. Teachers are to develop their own content. But they are, of course, busy teaching their classes and preparing for these classes. So how can they manage both tasks? What sort of models you have in Singapore to dedicate perhaps some of them to produce the content while others can teach their classes?
I think Singapore e-learning is interesting because they have tried so many models and there are a lot of experimentation that have gone on for the last 5 years. There are certain schools that have more resources and they have gone on to allow a few teachers to be totally offloaded from teaching to build e-learning content for 1 year. Mm. So of course that is a dream. Not every school can do that. So basically the rest of the schools, what they do is they have certain, they identify certain e-learning champions, teachers who are very comfortable with the use of IT and who have a lot of ideas, and the schools will give them certain resources. It can be certain money to buy certain tools or even to engage services, which we sometimes supply to the schools to help them to translate their ideas into e-learning objects. And the trick in the schools is always to build content fast because the needs from school vary so differently and the subjects coverage is so wide. So basically, we also ended up looking at the needs and we built tools to help the schools to be able to build content more rapidly.
Schools to rely on themselves to develop content and perhaps they can exchange in exchange programs, for example?
Oh yes, Dr. Amula, you brought up a very interesting concept that is used very much in Singapore. And the government has been trying very much to encourage schools to share content with each other. So we have been fortunate to be involved in a few of these projects. For example, in the eastern part of Singapore, covering about 90 schools, we are involved in a project in which we help the mathematics teachers to share content with each other. So there is a portal in which the teachers will load their content up and there'll be content featured. And the zone even allocated a budget for a full-time staff there to create content on behalf of the teachers.
Very important. Question, Dr. Salah.
When we talk about an LMS system, we talk about the heart of the e-learning process. But this heart should be connected to other departments, other systems in the school or in the university. So can your LMS be integrated with, for example, student information systems, financial systems, using, for example, authentications like LDAP or Active Directory for authenticating students or retrieving data from databases related to financial transactions?
Yes, you brought up a very interesting idea. In fact, I'm so happy that you brought this question because that's exactly how our company started. Our company started actually by taking the LMS that was first developed out of a polytechnic, and which was of course integrated with their systems, and later we merged with another company that also started from the National University of Singapore that built the e-learning system. And when they built the e-learning system way back in 1998, that was precisely why they wanted to build the LMS, because back then LMS technology was not very matured and the university had a lot of difficulty trying to integrate their student management systems with the LMS.
Or the HR or something
yes.
like this.
So basically, they wanted a single lock-on using the LDAP and all that to be able to unify all the different passwords and so on. So from there, they have actually a lot of experience trying to integrate back to the back-end systems such as student management.
Or databases. Now
we're also involved in projects to integrate back to the HR systems where you look at human resources records
Very
and so
interesting.
On.
Any final words you have for our dear viewers?
Well, firstly, thank you very much for this opportunity to share the experiences that we have in Singapore. And having seen the infrastructure and the people in Kuwait and basically the willingness to learn, I would say that e-learning can definitely take off here. I'm very impressed with, for example, the e-learning implementation that's taking place in the Kuwait Smart School, where every student has a laptop and basically that drives the teachers to want to be able to make full use of it. So, and I think that experiments like this are similar to experiments in Singapore where we try to push the boundaries of how technology can support the teaching and learning.
Thank you very much, Mr. Yi, for being with us this week. Thank you, our dear Dr. Salah.
Thank you.
For keep us informed with your marvelous jewels. And thank you, our dear viewer. This is an inauguration, as you heard, Mr. Yi, the beginning of the season, with the heavy rain today. I'm sure you enjoyed those big drops of rain. Let's meet you next week, inshallah, in good health. And until then, stay tuned with the good news and the good health. Till next week, keep in safe.
Thank you.